When some stars die, they explode in a huge supernova. But what separates a supernova from an, it's all right, I guess, nova? Hey everyone, Julian here for DNews. The sun is a miasma of incandescent plasma that's been burning for about 4.6 billion years. In another 5 billion, it'll run out of hydrogen fuel, and after going through some expansions and contractions, will eventually lose its outer layer, leaving a little glowing core called a white dwarf to cool off in space. As star deaths go, it's a pretty peaceful one, but sometimes stars just say YOLO and they go out with a blaze of glory. They explode with a flash brighter than the entire galaxy and send shockwaves shooting out in all directions. We call these explosions supernovae. So what separates our sun's fade to black from a grand finale? Something called the Chandrasekhar limit, named for Indian physicist Subramanian Chandrasekhar, who figured out why some stars go boom, and he did it at the age of 19, if you're feeling old yet. Chandrasekhar calculated that if a white dwarf has a mass about 1.4 times that of our sun's, it would not be able to fend off the force of gravity. It would collapse, but as it collapsed, it would ignite a runaway chain of fusion reactions and bam, supernova. So mass is the key to the galaxy's greatest fireworks show, and there are two ways stars can reach that Chandrasekhar limit. The first way is by leeching off another nearby star. If a white dwarf is in a binary system, it can pull matter from its partner until, like all unhealthy relationships, it ends in a fiery explosion. This is called a type 1A supernova. A type 2 supernova begins with a single star that was huge in the first place. A star would have to be at least 8 times more massive than our sun to have a core heavy enough to light that giant space candle. Stars that massive don't stop at fusing carbon and helium into oxygen like ours will. They'll burn neon, oxygen, and silicon to keep the fusion going. But once they create iron, they're done for, because iron uses more energy to fuse than it puts out. When the fusion can't be maintained, gravity wins out and the star contracts, cramming protons and electrons together into neutrons, unleashing a wave of neutrinos that would exert a huge outward pressure. The contracting outer layers would also rebound off the dense inner ones. When these layers slam into each other, heavier elements are created and distributed throughout space. The explosion also frees up elements like carbon and oxygen that would otherwise have been locked up in the star's core. So, from a star's death, we get life. Once the explosion dissipates as a nebula, it leaves behind a ball of densely packed neutrons called a neutron star that's only a few miles across. If the star was really massive, the neutrons would be crushed and form a black hole. And if the star was really, really massive, it leaves behind something called your mama. What? Because stars have to be so huge to explode, supernovae don't happen very often. In our galaxy, they only happen about twice a century. One star on supernova watch is Betelgeuse, burning off the shoulder of Orion. Betelgeuse is a red supergiant at least 430 light years away. When it does go, it'll be visible in daylight, but it probably won't explode for another 100,000 years, unless someone says its name 3 times. Betelgeuse is far from the most massive star ever discovered. The snappily named R136A1 holds that distinction at 256 solar masses. Stars like this are pushing the upper limits of size, and their supernovae will be mind-blowing. The largest supernova ever observed was seen by the All-Sky Automated Survey for Supernovae, or ASSASSIN. Designated ASSASSIN 15LH, the explosion was 20 times brighter than all the stars in our galaxy combined, 600 billion times brighter than the sun. The explosion released 10 times more energy than the sun will in its entire lifetime. But luckily, it was 3.8 billion light years away. Knowing how massive a star is gives us a good idea of what it'll do, but how do we figure that out in the first place? Trace explains here.
Weight is the measure of gravity's pull on our mass. It's relative. On different places on Earth or on different planets, our weight changes relative to gravitation. So obviously, you can't really weigh a star, but you can determine how much matter is inside, which can tell you a star's life story.
There are about as many questions to answer about stars as there are stars themselves. So if you have any more, go ahead and ask us down in the comments. Use the hashtag AskDNews. Subscribe for more, and I will see you next time on DNews.